Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Cambridge and welcome to the actual program. This is now the second year that the program is running. And I actually taught accounting and finance last year as well. So my name is Peter Szilagyi. I actually prepared a couple of slides, but it doesn't matter. I'm guessing it's only four slides, right? My name. It looks funny. It's pronounced Szilagyi. It's a Hungarian surname. Please call me Peter. Yes, I'm a lecturer at the business school in finance, and I have actually been here for this is my seventh year now, teaching accounting and finance at the university, at the business school, and the engineering faculty, and now the law faculty. So I have a great deal of experience, may I say, in teaching a course that we've been doing together. So this is a 16-hour course, and we will basically have to condense both accounting and finance into a very relatively short 16-hour course. I mean, this is actually quite a formidable task. So what we will actually be doing is literally just going through the basics. We will spend 6 hours in accounting and then 8 hours in finance. And as you will find, as you may have gathered from Peter's discussion before, it is actually very critical that you understand both accounting and finance in order to study corporate law. I mean, what we'll try to achieve in the course is basically to get you to understand how companies actually work and how taxation, as well as various other matters, affect their actual behavior. Okay, so accounting basically, how many of you have done accounting and finance, by the way? Or finance, just two of you. Okay, so all the more important that we actually do this course. So what is accounting? Accounting is basically the collection, processing, and dissemination of financial information by companies, right? And within that, there are two major areas, that's financial accounting and management accounting. Financial accounting basically collects and disseminates information for and disseminates information to all stakeholders involved with the company. And that doesn't just include shareholders and creditors, it also includes customers, suppliers, and most importantly, the government, the tax office, right? Whereas management accounting, which we're not actually be looking at because of shortage of time, basically is specifically related to the compilation of information for management for internal purposes to make decisions. For your objectives, what is critical is that we understand how financial information is collected, how it is actually compiled into the company's financial statements, and how you can actually analyze these financial statements to actually get meaningful information about the company's financial position and performance. And we will actually do all of that. So we will first learn what the three key financial statements of a company are. What are they? Anyone? That's the balance sheet, which shows the company's financial position. Income statement shows the company's performance. And then the cash flow statement, which shows the company's ability to generate cash. Now, the cash flow statement actually wasn't compulsory until the 1970s to issue. But now it is because for a company to survive, they actually need cash, right? So no matter how profitable you are on paper, if you don't have cash, you just go bankrupt, right? Because you won't be able to cover your imminent liabilities, right? The three key financial statements we will also learn how to construct from information that companies collect on a day-to-day basis. I mean, you can imagine that Tesco has billions of transactions a year, so it is actually quite a formidable task for the company to actually come up with the numbers in the financial statements. So we'll actually learn how to construct all of that, and then we will learn how to actually analyze the statements. We will look at various financial ratios related to, that's basically five key areas that we will be looking at. So we can actually learn to process the information that the company provides us ourselves. Okay. What about finance? I'm actually a lecturer in finance at the business school, so as you can imagine, I find this area much more exciting, and hopefully you will find that the same. And in particular, I also like, okay, a lot of you will think, what am I doing this for? Well, I do actually like to look at current events. So I do actually like to start at the beginning of each lecture talking about what is going on in the financial markets and the financial world. Of course, since the financial global financial crisis hit, we have had a range of issues arising on an ongoing basis. And you shouldn't be surprised if Hungary comes up in a discussion every now and then. As a Hungarian, okay, Hungary has been in the press quite a lot recently because we have a government that I'm not very happy with. So hopefully a few distinct examples from Hungary will also help you help us highlight certain issues in finance and financial markets. Okay, so what are we going to be looking at in finance? What is finance actually? Finance is basically the science of A, valuation on the one hand. It's called asset pricing. This basically deals with the pricing of financial assets in particular. What are the key financial assets? Okay. Corporate law. What are the key financial assets in relation to a company?
Land.
Financial assets.
Intangibles.
Okay, yes. I mean, finance deals with the valuation of all assets in the economy, right? Both financial and non-financial. This is actually critical to understand how much a company is actually worth, right? In relation to companies, there's two key types of financial, these are actually two financial liabilities, right, that companies have, which are
the company's debt. Yeah,
debt and equity, right? So what is that? It is the money owed to the company's creditors, and equity is what?
The claims of the shareholders.
The claims of the shareholders. And how do you actually get the claims of the shareholders? And this is actually very critical for the understanding of how companies actually work. So on the one hand, the company has assets, on the other it has liabilities, right? And then it has equity. Now, equity is your so-called residual, or shareholder's so-called residual claim, right? This is not necessarily money that they can take out of the company. Basically, the company has a certain amount of assets, that it has a certain amount that it has to pay back, and whatever is left goes to the shareholders, right? Yep. So this is actually a critical issue. The companies, what was I going to say? Yes, this is basically a critical issue. So the company has a certain amount of assets, it has a certain amount of liabilities to pay back, and whatever is left goes to the shareholders. And fundamentally, the company's objective should be to increase the value of equity, the value accrued to shareholders, right? And you will find that in the context of taxation, this actually has a very serious implications. Okay, so the first thing we will do in finance is basically look at the valuation of assets in general, meaning the valuation of non-financial assets such as land, the valuation of debt, as well as the valuation of equity. You will find that these are actually priced quite differently because they tend to have very different cash flow streams. Now, does anyone know where the value of an asset comes from? Why does an asset have value? Why? Why are you prepared to pay for a corporate bond, for instance?
Because of the perceived benefit.
So what is the benefit?
Well, it depends on the financial instrument.
What do you get? Future cash flows, right? So you will find that the fundamental idea of valuation in finance is that the reason why you are prepared to pay money for assets is because holding that asset or those assets will entitle you to future cash flows. So the current value of an asset is basically the discounted present value, so-called present value of all those future cash flows. Okay, so this is actually very, very critical, as you will find. And you will find that depending on the types or the patterns of the future cash flow streams, the valuation of assets can become very, very difficult. Okay, so we'll actually learn the very basics of valuation in the course. Okay, what will be then critical for us to discuss is basically the three key areas of corporate decision making, which are investment policy, financing policy, and payout policy. Now, what is investment policy? Investment policy is basically the investment decision-making process or capital budgeting process. The objective of a company is to generate wealth for shareholders. So the objective of management is basically to undertake investments, then generate higher cash flows than the initial, than the actual, or higher wealth than the actual initial cost. Right? Now, the context of corporate taxation will be very important to understand that when a company makes investments, the investments themselves are not actually tax deductible, right? The capital expenditures that the company makes to invest in assets to generate future income is not actually tax deductible, but instead you will basically get depreciation, or in the UK, a capital allowance that allows you to depreciate to account for the loss in the value of the investment that you have made. But the investments themselves are not tax deductible. And this, of course, has very critical implications for corporate behavior. Okay? Now, the second big area is financing policy. By financing policy, I mean that companies fundamentally fund themselves with debt collected from creditors and equity, which is basically money put up by shareholders. The question is it important where the money comes from to fund the company itself? And you will actually find that it is in fact critical. For one, when the money that you get from creditors, that is basically a fixed claim, so you know exactly how much you pay back. As in the case of equity, as we said, shareholders basically hold a residual claim. They just get whatever is left in the company. And this will actually create massive conflicts of interest between creditors and shareholders with respect to how the company's cash flows should be distributed. Another critical issue is that it's basically taxation. Whatever the company pays out to its shareholders in the form of dividends or share repurchases comes out of its net income, right? Which basically means that all of that is taxed, and that's what Peter also discussed earlier. Whereas credit, the interest that company pays on debt to creditors, that is actually tax deductible. And again, this completely, screw up, can actually completely screw up the incentives of companies with respect to financing themselves with debt and equity, and again, there's this massive conflicts of interest between creditors and shareholders that affect company behavior. Okay? Okay, so in terms of financing policy, we will look at the choice of debt versus equity and how that actually impacts the company's financial performance, financial position, and how that actually then potentially can affect the behavior of management as well as all the stakeholders involved in the company. Okay? Now the third area, payout policy, I have just alluded to. Two critical issues here. On the one hand, the money that the company redistributes to shareholders is not tax deductible. That comes out of the company's net income and can basically take two forms. How can companies compensate their shareholders? Does anyone know? As dividends and?
Capital gains.
Yeah, and how do you trigger capital gains? Payout policy. The company wants to distribute a certain amount of cash to its shareholders.
Share buybacks.
How does it do? Share buybacks, right? So if a company pays dividends, that money will actually be taxed at the level of the shareholders, right? Because they will have to pay dividend tax. Now, what about share repurchases? So how do share repurchases actually compensate shareholders? Well, you have a certain amount of equity, and if you actually reduce the number of shares that represent this amount of equity, then the share price, the price of the individual share has to go up. This is what we call capital gains or capital appreciation. The company is compensating its shareholders by increasing the its own share price by repurchasing some of its shares from the market. Okay? And the critical issue here will be that obviously from the perspective of the individual shareholders, dividend tax and capital gains tax will be very, very different. And this will actually very much depend on the country and on the type of shareholder you're talking about, whether it's an individual shareholder, financial institution, or a non-financial fund, etc. So you will see that in the context of corporate taxation, it's actually so the relative taxation of dividends and capital gains would actually be very, very critical in influencing company behavior as well. Okay, so these are the three big areas of finance that we will be able to look at in this relatively short course. So what else is there? Okay, so we have 16 hours. So what I will actually try to do is do 6 hours of accounting, and we just learn the basics so we know where the company information actually comes from and what the company actually looks like, and what each individual item means in the company's financial statements. And then we will spend 8 hours of finance, where we will first look at valuation, then we will look at investment policy, and financing policy, and finally payout policy. So these are really just the very basics, but hopefully you will find that the course is actually instrumental in your general understanding of corporate law, basically. Okay. I understand that we will be meeting on Wednesdays between 1 and 3, but at some point we might actually have two lectures a week at the request of the faculty, so we'll actually find out about that, like I said, later on. We will have the exam on the 11th of December, which will actually be a closed book exam. And don't freak out, but obviously both accounting and finance are quantitative, so the questions will require calculations. There will be basically 4 or 5 questions, of which you will have to answer 2.
And 1 on accounting, 1 on finance, right?
One on accounting and 1 on finance, yes. And you will have, or maybe 5 questions, 3 questions out of 5. But the bottom line is that you will have 2 hours to do it. And hopefully, if you actually, and we will actually be preparing for the types of questions that you can get, because I will actually give you basically homework, practice questions that you can take on, that we can go through them together in class. And I will also give you about the answers to all the questions in the book that we will be using, which is Ross Westerfield Jeff. What else is that? Any questions? There's always the issue about calculators. So the university is very stringent about this. The university has a certain list of approved calculators, and as a general rule, they will only allow one of these calculators into the examination room. And you will actually have to go to the university center and have a label stuck on your calculators that has actually been approved by the university. So this is actually very critical. Obviously, the idea being that you shouldn't use calculators that are too programmable, so you can include all the equations and all the data that you actually need. Okay, I think I've run out of time. Any questions on anything? No? Well, hopefully I can make the course interesting for you. As I said, I have great passion for finance, so we don't talk about current events, to put everything into context. And I will be able to send you articles, analyst reports, etc., as well as hopefully provide an understanding of how company taxation is relevant in the context of accounting and finance, or how accounting and finance is relevant to corporate taxation. Okay? So thank you very much, and I'll see you on Wednesday.